I will tell you that sometimes, usually, not sometimes, every time I preach, at some point in time, I kind of get excited and passionate. Some people have told me, man, you sound like you're yelling at me, dude. I remember one time my little sister was working with somebody, and she said, hey, check out this YouTube video that my brother preached on, I think, was it Mardi Gras or something like that? Yeah, if you love Mardi Gras, you're not going to love me. I'm just telling you right now. Straight up. Straight up pagan holiday, nothing but revelry and the worship of Bacchus. Anyway, today's Father's Day. Watch this YouTube my brother preached on Mardi Gras. She said, I couldn't sit in that church. That man yelling at me, veins popping out his head the whole time, just didn't sound like nothing, but he was mad at me. I'm not mad at you. I just want you to know that. Amen? So please don't think, if you leave here and you don't come back, I understand. This church isn't for everybody. But please don't leave here thinking I'm mad at you. I'm mad at one person, and one person only. His name is Satan, the liar. And you know what? They call him, the people that follow him call him Lucifer because they think he gives them light. But the reality of it is that his light brings darkness and it separates from the life of God. Amen. And he's been deceiving humanity for thousands of years. He's the one I'm mad at because he tried to destroy my life and he's trying to destroy your life. And he's trying to destroy your children's life. And that's what I want to talk to you about a little bit. Really more about children today, I guess, really than fathers. But, you know, one of the things before we get started about fathers, I think if I was going to title this morning's message, I'd probably title it Learning How to Walk. I can remember when I first worked offshore, I was thinking, you know, I'm not going to have kids while I'm working offshore. Please don't take it the wrong way. Working offshore is a great opportunity to make money. It was just in me. As I worked offshore, and I did for a while, I would listen to these men constantly talk about the fact that, man, while I was offshore this time, my kid did this, my kid did that. And I was thinking, Lord, I don't know. I mean, this is a great job. I've been able to provide for my family. But if you have something else for me, I'm just going to wait until I have kids because I don't want to miss everything. I know that I probably shouldn't even say that because so many men have to work offshore, man. And it's a great way to provide for your family. So I'm not trying to beat you up. I just want you to know I feel your pain and I've been there. But, you know, whenever a child learns how to walk, you know, takes their first steps, that's a big time. You know, that's a monumental milestone in a child's life. But what I'm talking about this morning really has to do with walking, amen, walking with God, walking for God. And many of you that come to the church and listen to most of the preaching, you hear repetitive themes. And the reason that you hear repetitive themes is because the Bible repeats it time and again. So I don't want you to get tired. Don't take a nap on me while everybody else is here. Because the truth is that today again talks about a journey. Each and every one of us are on a journey. Amen? It's not just the journey of life. I'm talking about to the child of God now. I'm talking about to the blood-bought, redeemed child of God. If you just happen to walk in this morning and you say, preacher, I don't know if I'm blood-bought or redeemed. Well, let me explain to you what that means. The word redeemed means to be purchased back. The first time you were born like your father Adam. That's what the Bible teaches. Jesus, when he told Nicodemus in John chapter 3, said, unless a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said, how can a man climb a second time into his mother's womb? Jesus said, no, you're thinking flesh, Nicodemus. You're thinking physical birth. What's born of the flesh is flesh. Now, I can tell you, I know what Jesus was talking about because I read the book. And what he was talking about is the first time that you're born in the flesh, in your physical birth, you're born physically of Adam. The Word of God teaches that Adam is the fountainhead of all humanity. What does that mean? All living life, all human beings spring forth from the loins of Adam. And whenever mankind was born, he was born like Adam, and Adam was already fallen. He was fallen in sin, and therefore man took upon himself the image of his father Adam rather than the way Adam was originally created, which was in the image and the likeness of God. The Word of God is clear on that. Genesis chapter 5, verse 3. After about 120 years, Adam had another son. His name was Seth. And he was born in the image and likeness of his father Adam. So yes, mankind was created in the image and likeness of God. But mankind was now born in the image and likeness of his father Adam. Therefore, God had a plan. Word of God says, and for this is not part of the message, this is just for you to know some things. Amen. 1 Peter 1:18, you were not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver or gold, but instead you were purchased. You were purchased with the blood of a lamb, which was foreordained before the foundation of the earth. That's what the word redeemed means. It means to be purchased. To be purchased back. How were you purchased? Through the shedding of blood. Not just any blood. Your blood could not be shed. That's why the religion of Islam is a lie. And I told that woman that in the clinic. No, ma'am. The hadith, which is part of a commentary of the Quran, says that with one drop of the martyr's blood, all his sin is atoned. No, that's a lie. The martyr's blood can't atone for sin because the martyr's blood is tainted with sin.
Right, right.
Sinful blood cannot purchase back sinful humanity. Amen? It required one to be born without sin. Jesus was born of the Father. He was born of the Virgin. There was no sin in Him. He offered His righteousness on the cross in payment for the penalty of your sin and for my sin. And as you travel this journey called life, and seeds of the gospel are planted in your heart, and you're told the truth, at some point in time, the Holy Spirit begins to stir upon your heart. He begins to deal with you on the inside, and He says, hey, I gave you a free will. I gave you a free will, a choice to make on this side of eternity. And my desire for you, my hope for you, is that you will make a choice, and you will take that free will and the faith that I've given you, and you will place it in my plan. What is your plan, God? My plan is to create an eternal family. My plan is to create an eternal family and to offer a sinless sacrifice to buy back the sinful so that they might now become part of my eternal family and rule and reign with me and live with me for all eternity. But they're going to have to buy in. They're going to have to buy into my story. First off, they're going to need to know the story and even to be able to buy into it. And it's so difficult, like I was praying earlier, as we live in this physical world, to get past all of the things that we touch with our senses. We're sensual creatures. I don't necessarily mean that in a sexual way. Do what you want with it. I'm saying sensual in the sense of senses. You see things, you taste things, you feel things, amen, you hear things. And this physical world draws upon you and wants to hold you close to it. And Jesus is saying, don't let the cares of this world choke out the gospel. Don't let it happen. I'm telling you right now, the enemy of your soul wants to cause the cares of this world to choke the gospel message out of your life. And for you at the end to find out that you squandered the whole thing that He gave you. And so as I speak to fathers this morning, and I talk about instruction, we need to be real clear. Because in some of these passages, I've had preachers try to say before, like in instance, as you train up a child in the way that they should go, that me as a father is supposed to watch my kid and to determine which career is best for them, and that that's what that's talking about. Hold on a second. Yeah. This book is not about career options.
Right.
This book is not about career options. This book is about learning how to walk with God. Amen? Yeah. This book is about learning how to have a relationship with the living God. And if I would teach my children how to have a relationship with Him, how to hear His voice, how to be submissive to His will, then He will speak to them and He will reveal to them His heart, His plan for their life. I know He can do it. He did it for me. As I was standing out there on that rig one night, I was a snubbing hand. You don't even know what that is probably, and it's okay, it's not that important, but I was in the oil field and I was a snubbing hand. Probably one of the worst jobs you can have in the oil field. One of the most dangerous jobs in the oil field, one of the dirtiest jobs in the oil field. Full of hydraulic. Oh man, it was nasty. I don't even want to tell you what that stuff was doing to my body, man. I had bumps everywhere. I was a mess. You know, I was sitting out there, and it was about 2 o'clock in the morning. I was swabbing the deck, or, you know, we were on a rig job or whatever, and all of a sudden, I was under the light, and the Lord spoke to my heart. He said, I got something else for you. I got something else for you. And right there, I knew I was supposed to go to college. Don't tell me how I knew it. I just knew it, and I made a decision. I'm going to college, and I didn't know where I was going to end up, but I thank the Lord that He spoke to me that night. He'll speak to you. He'll speak to your children. But listen, we have to desire and want God to be number one in our life. I can tell you that at that point in my life, He wasn't even where He needed to be. I had other things that I had in front of God, but nevertheless, He broke through and He spoke. Amen. You know, as fathers, one of the things I was thinking of is that for a father to desire to instruct their children in the ways of God, they themselves are going to have to, number one, be convinced about the ways of God. And number two, they're going to have to know the ways of God for their own self.
Yeah.
But what I mean by that is, I was even talking to somebody yesterday. I like to go to the gym some. I go to the gym now more probably than I ever did before. But you know, you got to be careful that you don't let things take over your life. If I'm at the gym, I can assure, don't get me wrong, it's not that I never ask questions about certain little muscle groups, because I don't really know a whole lot about all that. I'm not going to spend too much time in there. But I'll talk to somebody and ask them a question. Hey, man, how can I build this little internal aspect of my quads or my thighs up a little bit, you know? But for the most part, I want to talk to people about Jesus. What I'm trying to say is this, is that you can have a group of men at the gym, and that's what they're talking about. Some of them are talking about growth hormone. They're talking about steroids. They're really getting into it over here. You got another group of men over here, and they're talking about wildlife and fisheries. You know what I'm saying? And they're anglers, man. They know just the bait to pick, just the time. They know the little sweet spot. And look, some of them are talking about the blind, right? Come on, Robert, you know these people. They got blinds in certain areas, man, and they're all ready. Listen, I'm not trying to come against any of that stuff. If you're a hunter and you're a fisher, that's fine. We got to make sure that these things aren't number one in our life is the point that I'm trying to make. And all of these things, and listen, if it's not that, they're talking about the party. And I hate to say it, but you get a group of men together, and they're not talking about hunting, fishing, or the saints. They might be talking about other women. You know what I'm saying? And their conversation, the topic of their conversation isn't just how beautiful she is, but what they want to do with her. Whenever they're not supposed to do that. And we're all guilty. Lord, help us. But what I'm trying to get at is this, is that as we navigate or travel this journey called life and we desire to be the men of God, then we're going to have to be convinced in and of ourselves of the pathway that we want to travel. God has a distinct way of convincing us that this world isn't really what we want. Does anybody know what I'm talking about?
Amen.
Have you tried to find fulfillment in the gym yet? Because I can tell you, you're not going to find it there. I don't care how beautiful you make, try to make your body look, it's never going to bring you fulfillment on the inside of your heart. I don't care how big the deer is that you kill, how big the bass is that you catch. I don't care whether you can just go on and on with that. I don't care how high you get, how drunk you get, how cool the party was. It's never going to. I don't care how beautiful your children are. None of these things that life has to offer are going to bring you fulfillment because there's a hole in your heart. And there's only one thing that fits in that hole, and his name is Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. And I'm not just talking about putting him in there. I'm talking about being convinced that each and every day, he's what you need. I'm preaching to the preacher. Each and every day, he's what I need. If I got a hole and I'm feeling empty, I need to keep putting Jesus in there. Amen?
Amen.
And so the father that's going to instruct his children in the ways of God must first come to the conclusion that what the world has to offer isn't going to get him where it is that he needs to go. I hope that I made that clear to you this morning. Because each and every one of us are at different levels of our journey. And each and every one of us are at different levels of being convinced. Secondly, you got to understand something. If the father doesn't understand the word of God for himself, if the father doesn't understand the ways of God for himself, then there's no way that he can teach them to his children. Now, think about what I'm saying. Can I get a raise of hands of anybody in here that is actually a pretty good fisher? Come on, just raise your hand if you are. All right, thank you, man. Praise God. What my point is that, you know what, you got to put some time into that. You know what I'm saying? I mean, if you're really going to be good at it. You got to put some time into that. You got to know which baits work. I mean, what about golf? I know some golfers. I tried to go play golf with Robert 3 times. I'm done. I don't have time for that.
You're going to be pretty decent at golf.
Yeah? You know what I'm talking about then. You got to know how to hit the ball. You can't just get up there and try to manhandle that thing. It goes into everybody breaking people's windows. I learned real quick after the second trip with Robert, this isn't for me. I want to hit stuff hard. I don't care whether it goes straight or not. I just want to hit it. It doesn't work. I don't have time to spend on that. You understand what I'm getting at? If a man wants to instruct his children in the ways of God, he's going to have to know the ways of God. Amen? All right, let's go to our first Bible passage. It says right here in Proverbs chapter 2. Proverbs were written by Solomon, who was the son of King David, who the Bible says was a man after God's own heart. Bible says right here, it says, my son. So right now, we already know that we're hearing the instructions of a father. He says, if you will receive my words and hide my commandments with thee. The word receive means not only just to hear, but to take them into yourself. Amen. So whenever you and I, it's not just about reading the Bible. I want you to know that. I've thought that for many years. It's not just about reading the Bible. You must read the scriptures. You must have a desire to understand the scriptures. And you must take the scriptures into yourself to where they become part of who you are.
Amen.
So that you incline your ear unto wisdom and you apply your heart to understanding. The application of the word. Amen. When you apply something to your life, you have an understanding of it, and it becomes part of your daily life. You're determined to allow it to become part of who you are. Basically, you're practicing the Word of God. Yes, if you cry after knowledge and you lift up your voice for understanding. Now listen, we taught this a while back, and I just want to make a point because some of you weren't here. You know, the word knowledge, the basic concept of the word knowledge is that it's information. It's information related to God. Does that make sense? This book is full of information. If you never crack it open and you never read it, you never apply yourself to studying it, you will never have any revelation at all about the knowledge of God. You might know which bait to use. You might know how to make the golf head hit the ball flat or whatever you got to do that. Twist your arm right and all this kind of stuff. But if you never apply yourself to the Word of God and never put the information on the inside of you, listen to me, it's not just the preacher's job. I'm going to do my job. Amen? I will commit to you that I will do my best to study the Word of God, to put it in me, to understand it so I can communicate it to you because God's called me to do that. I'm going to stand before the throne of God one day and I'm going to give an account on how I handled His Word and the communication of it to His people. I'm going to have to be given account. I'm responsible. It's not my job. It's a calling. God called me. I was in a barroom bathroom trying to go to church. Trying to live my life for God. Ended up in a barroom bathroom and the Holy Ghost showed up and He spoke to me. He spoke to me in the midst of pain and suffering and sorrow and heartache. And He said, present my word for the way that it's written and then I will use you. I got a mandate by God. God's going to keep a hold of me. He's going to preserve me. He's going to build a hedge around me. Amen. I just got to keep my eyes focused on Jesus. Amen. And to present the living word. I'm going to do that. But it's not my job to make you do all. You got to do some of the work yourself. Amen. It's okay to tell you the truth, right? You got to go home and you got to apply yourself to the knowledge of God. And anytime if fishing baits are more important, if your golf swing is more important, if killing the deer is more important, if finding out the best growth hormone to make your traps bigger is more important, or whatever the case, if it's more important, then guess what? The knowledge of God has not become pleasant to you yet. And so the word knowledge is information. In order to get the information of God, then you're going to have to put it in, and it's in this book right here. You're going to have to open it up. The next thing I wanted you to know that we learned was that wisdom had to do with application or to apply the Word of God. See, when you get the knowledge of God on the inside of you at a level, then you can now start to understand it a little bit. You can start to understand it a little bit, and now God will allow that to be mixed with life experience to the point where you now find yourself in life situations and you can apply the Word of God in your life. Amen? Whenever you start to apply the Word of God in your life on more than one occasion, before long you start to gain understanding. Now what I mean by that is this. I was hoping that somebody would have been here this morning because they would have understood what I was talking about. You start to really get it, I guess I would say. You get it, you start to know it. And you know, there was when we first started this Bible study, there was just a few of us. And one of the things that the Lord showed me after I had lived for the Lord, tried to live for the Lord for 12 years, and repeatedly failed Him. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? You don't have to raise your hand, but you get my point. Trying to live for God, but repeatedly failing Him. Guess what? He didn't give up on me. He don't want to give up on you. He's not a respecter of persons. He loves you. Hallelujah. He sent His Son as a gift for you. A gift of righteousness. Amen?
Amen.
And what I want you to know, though, is this, is that repeatedly I failed God. And one day after the Lord got a hold of me, after that barroom experience, I was sitting there and I was contemplating. I was contemplating the move of God on my life. A revelation of the finished work of Jesus on the cross. Not just so that I get to go to heaven, but for today. I'm talking about faith in Him and His righteousness and how that makes me righteous. And when I keep my faith there, God allows grace to flow in my life, and grace is power from God, and God begins to empower me, and He strengthens me, and He holds the forces of evil at bay. Amen. He gives me victory in my walk. He gives me strength to go on. I'm sitting there and I'm like, Lord, it's almost like you turned a light switch. I was bound. I couldn't see straight. And you showed up and you did a work in my life.
Amen.
What is it, Lord? What was the problem? He said, you were willing to sip it one more time, son. You were willing to sip it one more time. And as long as you're willing to sip it one more time and you take that sip, it's going to continue to be that way for you. And it's the same way for each and every believer. If we're willing to sip it one more time. You know, the person I talked to yesterday, this is what he told me about 3-4 years ago. His way of saying it was to take the sin challenge. In other words, you're going to think you can play around with it? Go ahead. Play around with it. Take the sin challenge. See what happens. See where it leads you. And I can tell you that if that person would stand up to you today and tell you where it led him, he would tell you that it led him a whole lot further than he planned on going.
Amen.
Sin is more powerful than you, and it's more powerful than me. What I'm trying to tell you is this, though, is that knowledge is the information of God, and when you put it in, you can begin to apply it in your life circumstances, and sooner or later, you begin to get the understanding of God. You start to get it. You start to apply the wisdom of God in your life. You start to gain victories in your life. And before you know it, with time, you start to get it a little bit. You start to understand it, and you can start seeing ahead where there might be problems that lie. Amen. God wants to go before you. He wants to lead and guide you in all truth. Amen. But in order for a father to be able to instruct his children in the ways of God, he first must understand the word of God. He must put the information in him. He must begin to apply the information in his own life and hopefully come to a place in his walk with God that he understands it well enough that it becomes part of the topic of their conversation. Amen. It goes on to say right here, verse 4, if you seek her, talking about wisdom, talking about knowledge, as silver, and search for her as for a hidden treasure. I mean, he's telling his son that the word of God, the commandments of God, the knowledge of God are more precious than a treasure. Understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. Verse 6, for the Lord gives wisdom. Out of his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. He lays up sound wisdom for the righteous. I like this right here. He is a buckler to them that walk uprightly. The word buckler was a word for a small shield. God wants to be your protection. Amen. There's many times that you're going to be on this earth and you're going to feel like people are coming against you. The enemy of your soul will use human beings to come against you. To come against you and to frustrate you. You understand that? He will cause people on the job. He will cause people in your family to come against you. Many times they're Christians. Christians don't even realize it, but half the time they're being used by the spirit of Antichrist more than they're being used by the spirit of Jesus. That's right. They don't realize that they're not doing it on purpose, but they're allowing themselves to be led by the flesh, and they're causing damage and destruction in other people's lives instead of allowing themselves to be led by the power and the person of the Holy Spirit, that they might bring encouragement, that they might build up, that they might help strengthen the child of God. God wants to be your buckler. Amen. He wants to be your shield as you navigate this journey. As a matter of fact, in this passage we're reading 7 times, it talks about walk, path, or the way. And what I told you before is I'm talking about learning how to walk. Learning how to walk with God. We need instruction in our life. Fathers need to know how to teach their own children how to walk in the ways of God. I'm not trying to say that part of this isn't a mother's job. And some of you may be single moms. And you have a hard job. You have a hard job if you're a single mom. Amen? Because you're over here trying to play both roles. And sometimes I run into men that play both roles. And it's not an easy thing to do. But I want to tell you that God, if you're a father, God is going to hold you personally accountable for how you chose to raise your children.
That's right.
And I'm going to get into that a little bit, but you're the one. You're the one, Dad. I'm the one. We're the one that's going to stand before God and give an account for how we handled our business with God and God's children that He entrusted unto us. goes on to say right here, but he wants to give you protection. And see, now this is the words of a father instructing his child and letting him know you need to get the word of God and you need to hide it in your heart like a treasure. Before your child leaves your house, I hope that you've taken the time to let him understand that the kingdom of God and the word of God is like a treasure for the inside of his heart, and that it will hold on to that and trust in that each and every day as he travels this journey. God is going to protect him. Amen?
Amen.
Not only will he protect him, but he says right here in verse 8, he keeps the paths of judgment and he preserveth the way of his saints. The word preserveth means to keep a close eye on and to build a hedge around. You see, God doesn't want his children to stumble. God doesn't want his children to veer off of path. God wants to help keep us on the right pathway and help us to continue to go in the right direction. Amen? The word of God placed in our heart helps us to be aware of that. It says right here, verse 10, when wisdom enters into your heart and knowledge is pleasant unto your soul. Yeah. Has wisdom entered your heart yet? Has wisdom entered your heart and has the knowledge of God become pleasant to your soul?
Amen.
What I mean by that is that when you read the word of God and you see it and God's word is speaking to you, that you can feel it on the inside of you. You can feel the love of God moving and operating in the midst of your heart. Or is there other things that still, I mean, I'm not saying that there won't be anything else that brings you pleasure on earth. That's not what I'm getting at. But the thing that brings you the most pleasure on earth, whatever that is, does the word of God look anything like that in your life? Amen? Because it should. Amen? All right. It goes on to say that when wisdom enters your heart and knowledge is pleasant to your soul, discretion will preserve you and understanding will keep you. To deliver you from the way of evil men, from the man that speaks froward things. You know, I shared this story a while back. As a matter of fact, I was in the gym, I guess about 3 months ago, 4 months ago, I don't know. And when I walked in, and I apologize for the people that have already heard the story, but, you know, it says froward and perverse. You know, there's a right way and a wrong way. And there was a group of men, and, I kind of was there early. And one guy came in, and two of them were talking, and one of them had left his third job, and he was talking about how he didn't like the way his boss was treating him, and so he's about to go get him another one. Complaining. I had heard him complain about two or three different times, you know, before. I was kind of listening. I probably shouldn't be listening to other people, but they're talking loud enough to where I can hear. And so he's complaining to that. And then I can't even really remember what the second guy was complaining about. Oh, one of them was talking about marriage. And he said that how his marriage, like he had already gotten married once and he had gotten divorced. And he said he wasn't ever going to try that again. And so instead, he was just going to kind of, you know, do his thing. And then the last one, I don't remember what he said. But anyway, whenever another guy showed up, and it was kind of funny because it was like he knew them all. And he called the first dude out, and he said, hey, man, did you get your new job? And it was like he knew the guy, and he knew that he had gone through about three or four different jobs in the last year or so. And it was funny to me that he said that to him. I mean, I guess, I don't know, maybe it wasn't too funny to him, but I was just kind of watching all this. And then the next thing you know, he asked the other guy, hey man, you something about marriage, and that's when the dude was like, oh no, man, I ain't doing that again. And then all of a sudden, the same guy starts talking about some girl that they all knew that goes to the gym, and how she looked, and whatever the case, and they started engaging in conversation about this girl and how, you know, whatever, and starting to use some choice words about her. And I can remember that all of a sudden something came over me, and I just opened my mouth. Some people would call me obnoxious. Some people would call me rude. I do. I introduce myself into people's life too much. I said, man, I've been listening to you guys for the last hour. I said, you over here complaining about, you know, the boss did this, the boss did that. Truth of the matter is that, you know what, we work for the boss. And the fact is that if we learn how to work for God that way, then we would learn how to please the Lord. And we wouldn't be so consumed and concerned about how it seems like the boss is treating us in our life. And you know, and whatever else I said about the girl and you know, y'all were over here talking about this. What about Jesus? I asked him, I said, what about Jesus? Have you thought that maybe if you introduced him into your life, that it might make a change on the way that you feel and the way that you see God? You know, and so the guy that had walked in, he asked me if I was gay. And so, you know, and I said, that's pretty funny. I understand what you're saying. You want to know, and I understand why you would say that. No, I'm not gay. And I'll tell you what, tomorrow when I come back, I'll tell you the same thing if you're talking about the same thing. I'll tell you that what you need is Jesus. Okay, and because he's the one. And I don't care how pretty the girl is, she's not going to bring you fulfillment. It's Jesus. He's the one that we need, amen, on the inside of our heart. The reason I brought that up is because it says right here that the understanding of God will deliver you from the way of evil men, from the man that speaks froward or perverse things. The world does not understand the things of God. You understand that? And if you understand, the more you understand the things of God, and the more you're around the world, the more you will start to recognize the difference between the world and the kingdom of God. Just because you raised your hand one time in a service and said, yeah, Jesus, I love you and I believe you died on the cross, if the Holy Spirit didn't enter into your heart and to change you, you're not born again. I'm not talking about perfect life. I'm talking about whenever you get saved, the Holy Ghost lives in your heart and he begins to move you in another direction.
Amen.
He begins to deal with your heart. Amen. And it says right here, who leave the paths of uprightness to walk in the ways of darkness. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 22 real quick. Proverbs 22. I've been told by more than one person that I need to slow down. If y'all don't have a Bible, by the way, we got a bunch of King James Bibles on the back there. We're going to need to get our little screen fixed up here. I use the King James. I'm kind of old school. But I think it's a literal translation, and I got my reasons. One day we'll talk about it. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6. It says to train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Now, this is the scripture that the preacher said, described, you're supposed to find out what their calling in life is, as far as possibly what career or whatever the case. But what I'm trying to tell you is that this is a book on how to teach people to live for God and to come into covenant relationship with God. Amen. The word train there literally is described as a word dedicate. To dedicate a child into the way that they should go. As a matter of fact, this is the only time it's used of a human being, and three other times it's once used as for a house, and another time it's used for the temple. Two other times it's used for the temple that Solomon made whenever he dedicated it to the Lord and he offered sacrifice. According to Deuteronomy, you don't have to turn there if you don't want, but Deuteronomy is the fourth book of the Bible. It says in Deuteronomy chapter 20, I just wanted to give you an example of the word where it's used in Deuteronomy as far as for the house. Deuteronomy chapter 20. And it's verse 5. It says, and the officers shall speak unto the people, saying, what man is there that hath built a new house and has not dedicated it? Let him go and return to his house, lest he die in battle, and another man dedicate it. The idea there was that this man built the house, but the idea was that in order for it to really be dedicated, you had to be able to live in it for at least a year. And to settle down in your house. Because that's the purpose of a house, right? To live in a house. And so if you had built your house, but you hadn't really had the opportunity to live in it, it really not had been dedicated yet to its purpose. Amen? The temple of God. What is the purpose? See, because all this has really to do more than anything with purpose. What is the purpose of the temple of God? Why did they dedicate it with sacrifices? Well, whenever you and I have learned, the people that have been with us, according to Exodus 25 verse 8, God told Moses, build me a sanctuary or a tabernacle, which is a tent, so that my presence might dwell with my people. The tabernacle was a mobile tent for Israel as they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. Ultimately, when they came into the promised land, Solomon built a temple, a stationary house for the presence of God. The purpose of the temple was that sacrifices would be offered, because without the shedding of blood, God's presence cannot dwell with sinful man. And so whenever Solomon dedicated the temple with the sacrifices, the purpose of the temple was there. We're talking about purpose. purpose of the temple is God's presence dwells with his people. The purpose of a house is that you live in it. And the purpose of a child and training them up is that they might live their lives for God. I'm talking about children that are born in a household of people who call themselves Christian. The purpose of a child that's born into a Christian home, into a godly home, is not that they might become a good doctor. Come on, somebody. Listen, I know people that grew up in the church that became doctors, but they hadn't talked about Jesus in the last year. What good does it do for a man to attain a level of becoming a physician who has an opportunity to speak Jesus into people's lives because he was born in a home of God-fearing parents that raised him in the ways of God, but yet he won't speak about Jesus when he has the opportunity for? No, your purpose is to train your children that they might understand that there's a certain way that they're supposed to travel. There's a life that they're supposed to live. And if you will take the time to train them, then when they grow old, they won't depart from it. They won't quit it. They won't turn off. They won't veer off of path. When the Lord got a hold of my heart finally at the church I was going to, I'm just telling you what happened. I got to that scripture. I looked around. I stopped. I started applying the Word of God to my life. All of a sudden, scales had fallen from my eyes, and I started looking around spiritually. And I said, we got a problem. What's going on, Lord? Even the preacher's kids don't live for God. There's none of these children living for God. Nobody's talking about God. Nobody loves God. Ever tried to talk to somebody before? And you're like, hey, man, Jesus loves you, dude. Can I tell you what Jesus did for you? He died on the cross, man. He hung naked in the noonday sun for your sin. He loves you so much. And you're sitting there talking to a Christian about this. And this is what they're doing. You going to keep talking to that person? I tried. Oh, I tried so hard. I had to go find another one. Hey, can I tell you about, let me tell you what Jesus did for me. Man, I was in a barroom bathroom. I was running from God. And the voice of God spoke on the inside. And he started bubbling up in my belly. And he told me, if you'll present my word for the way it's written. And then about 5 minutes. Come on, dude. We used to talk about the saints, bro. What happened? I remember one guy told me, come on, man. Come on. What's all this about? I'm like, what is it about? Jesus got a hold of my heart, man. He became real.
Yes.
Amen.
And you're over here looking at him and you're trying to plead with him, and that's what happened. It's like all of a sudden my eyes were open and I said, what's going on? And the Lord spoke to my heart. He said, they're not really training their children up in the ways of God. Now they drop them off at Sunday school. Drop them off in the children's church. Fathers aren't living. They're not instructing their children in the ways of God. They haven't allowed my word to become part of their heart to where it becomes the topic of their conversation when they talk to their children to try to teach them the difference between the world and the kingdom of God because they themselves have not become convinced. I'm convinced that God allowed things to happen in my life for a purpose so that I might be able to tell somebody, listen to me. We need to allow the Lord to reveal to us that we don't want the things of the world. We want the things of God. We need to train our children up in that. All right, Exodus chapter 12. We're talking about God's instruction. People that come to this church are very familiar with this passage of scripture. But I wanted to point a couple things out because we're talking about the children of Israel. The background story behind Exodus chapter 12 is that the children of Israel have been Egyptian slaves for all of this time. Amen. And God sends Moses as a deliverer to deliver them out. Passover night was the night that God told Moses, you take a lamb and you cut its throat and you collect its blood and you paint blood on the doorpost. On the doorpost and the side post. Interesting how it makes a cross like that. You put blood on the doorpost and the side post, and he said, I'm going to send the death angel through the camp. And whoever doesn't have blood painted on their door, wrath is coming to their house. Judgment is coming to their house. Egypt is the world. Pharaoh is Satan. The children of Israel are the Christian today. And I'm here to tell you, please make sure you apply the blood of Jesus to the doorpost of your heart, because judgment will come on the land again. Amen? And if you die before then, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And that day, when you take your last breath, judgment comes. Please apply the blood of Jesus to the doorpost of your heart. What are you talking about, preacher? Receive him as your Lord and Savior. Amen. Cry out to him and say, Lord, I know I'm a sinner and I need your cross. I need your sacrifice and the blood that you shed to forgive me of my sin. Amen. That's what happened on Passover night. But there's three things that I wanted to tell you that I saw that I believe is important for the instruction of our children. Number one, verse 19 of Exodus chapter 12, it says, 7 days there shall be no leaven found in your houses. Y'all know what leaven is? What is it? Yeast?
Yeah.
That's right. Leaven is the same thing as yeast, but in the Bible it's sin.
It's sin.
Leaven always represents sin. Jesus actually said it in the New Testament. He said, talked about the doctrine of the Pharisees and that it was leaven. Jesus said a little leaven leavens the whole lump. What ends up happening is that when you allow sin to, yeast, it begins to ferment and it spreads. That's the same thing that sin will do. If you allow it unchecked in your life, it'll begin to spread. It'll begin to spread and it'll take over. And so what he's talking about here is that he's showing us right here that for 7 days there shall be no leaven found in your houses, for whosoever eats that which is leavened, even that soul shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he be a stranger or born in the land. You shall eat nothing leavened in all your habitations, that you shall ye eat unleavened bread. First point I wanted to make to you is this, is that our diet isn't the same diet as the world. We don't eat sin. And I wanted to say that this is something that our children need to be instructed on. They need to understand the difference between how the world handles their business and how the children of God handle their business. And for me, I could go on and on about a lot of things, but I'm going to pick one thing that really sticks out to me because I'm the one that gets to preach, and it's rebellion. See, for me, rebellion was a real problem in my house. And what I mean by that is I didn't tolerate it. I'm far from a perfect father. You do what you want in your house. I wasn't going to tolerate rebellion from a child. Now, you got to understand something. Rebellion starts off early, early, early in the midst of a child. Mm-hmm. All you got to do is take a little bit of time and pay attention. And we're going to talk about paying attention in a little bit. Because most people aren't paying attention. So y'all just pay attention. Rebellion is a symptom that there's a problem. The Word of God says that the rod of correction will drive foolishness from the heart of a child. And in my house, you know what the Lord showed me was that it was important for me to instruct my children. And so I have. I've been far from perfect, but I'm telling you, every waking moment, every chance I had, every time I saw something, sometimes to the point of nausea, I'm telling you, my kids would be silent. I wasn't trying to beat them up. I wasn't trying to make them angry. No, but I had to tell them it's my job, and I would constantly remind them the reason I'm doing this, baby, God's going to hold me accountable. Sooner or later, you're going to be of an age where you're going to be out there and you're going to live your own life. You're going to walk your own journey. Just don't ever say that your daddy never took the time to try to explain it to you. Amen? And I can remember whenever my youngest one, she's with the nursery. She's young. Your kids are safe if Bella's got them. She's a good girl. But I would try to talk to her. And I would see her roll her big eyes. I'm talking like 3 years old. 3, 4 years old. Even Sierra went to them, trying to explain something to them, instruct them. And you go to turn their head and don't turn your head when I'm talking to you. I grab that chin and flip it back around and say, when I'm talking to you, you pay attention to me because I'm your daddy. You may not like what I'm telling you, but I'm here to tell you that this is how it's going to roll in my house. When I'm talking to you, you pay attention to me because I'm your father and the words that I have to speak to you are important. And rebellion gets a spanking. Mm-hmm. You don't listen to what I'm trying to... Listen, after I've taken the time, I'm not trying to make myself more than what I'm supposed to be, but I did work all day. Amen. Well, you got some food in your belly. You got a roof that you're living under. You got clothes on your back. Just that alone ought to be able to give me the opportunity to speak into your life. Now I've taken more time to instruct you, to speak to you, and to explain to you the things that God, not just your daddy, but God expects from you. And you're going to backtalk me? You're going to backtalk your daddy? And you're going to roll your eyes at me? Oh no! That was the biggest mistake you made, because now it's time for the rod of correction. Because I got to get your attention, kid. We're going to talk about that in a little bit. Sin, rebellion, it will eat at the heart of your child. If you allow it to go unchecked in your home, I'm telling you, you think you got a problem today. Next week, she's going to come home. He's going to come home. He's going to say, I go where I want. I listen to what I want. I watch what I want and I do what I want. As a matter of fact, I'm about to start bringing it up in your house, Daddy. Me and Jimmy going to the room. And if you think that that kind of stuff doesn't go on in people's houses, you're wrong. I'm here to tell you, you got the wrong house, little mama. Because that kind of stuff, you ain't going to get past 3 years old with that attitude. You need to be convinced. Psychology is lied to society. Psychology is lied to society. The Word of God says that the rod of correction will drive foolishness out of the heart of a child. I'm not talking about beating your kid. I'm not talking about treating your child improperly. I'm talking about true love. Word of God says in Hebrews, and we're not going to turn there, that God chastens those whom He loves. The word chasten means to instruct and to discipline. He chastens those whom He loves because He loves them. Because He's not nearsighted. Because He knows that if I don't deal with this thing right now, right here, we're going to have a big old mess up ahead on the road.
Amen.
You need to have that kind of wisdom in your life, sir. Father, you need to have that kind of wisdom in your life. To realize that, listen, God didn't call you to be His friend. God called you to be His father. To take a stand and to speak forth the things of the Word of God into His life. So number one, we don't eat the diet of the world. We don't eat sin. But what we do eat, verse 9. I'm sorry, verse 8. And they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Eat not of it raw, nor sodden at all with water, but roast with fire his head with his legs and with the pertinence thereof. You know, the Word of God says that this was a lamb that was roasted. Fire, I forgot to tell you too, I sweat a lot when I preach. Fire represents judgment. Judgment on the brazen altar. They took the animal, they skinned the animal. They split the animal open. They inspected the insides of the animal. And then they offered that animal on the fire and it was roasted. With the judgment of fire. Jesus, see, the altar represents the cross. The fire represents the judgment of God. Jesus was the lamb that was placed on the cross so that the judgment of God might be placed upon Him, so that it might be removed off of you. This is the diet that we feed our children, and we let them understand the God we serve offered a sacrifice. Amen. We keep our faith in what He provided, which was His Son, the eternal Lamb. We keep our faith in that each and every day. He is our righteousness. And whenever we learn to believe that and walk in that, and we walk under the covering of righteousness, once again, grace flows in our life and we're strengthened. Listen, just like you eat protein and carbohydrates and your body breaks them down and turns them into calories so that your body can have energy for movement, whenever you feed on Jesus in the spiritual realm, your body is given grace and it empowers you to be able to walk in the spiritual realm. That's your diet. Third thing I wanted you to see was this, verse 11. We're talking about the journey again. Exodus 12, verse 11. It says, and thus shall you eat it, with your loins girded. Now, I've already told you what that means. I've taught that many times in the Old Testament, or not even just in the Old Testament. They would wear those long flowing robes, right? They'd have a belt. Whenever they were getting ready to go on a journey, they'd pull that robe up from behind. They'd stick it up under the belt and they'd pull it up. I'm not trying to be weird, but it's kind of like, I guess, like a jock strap a little bit, but not just that. It helped prevent that flowing rope from getting in the way. Man, I'm on a journey. I don't have time for things to slow me down. I'm about to get up and get out of here. Passover night, when the death angel comes through, God wants His people ready to get up and to get out. You're on a journey. He said, not only are you supposed to have your loins girded, but you need to eat it with your shoes on your feet, and you need to have your staff in your hand. You're getting up and you're getting out. Amen?
Amen.
The people of God, this is a temporary place for them. This earth is not their home. You're on a journey, and God's wanting you to get up, get out of the world, amen, and to hold on and keep on walking with Him. Now, I wanted to tell you all of this because this is the instruction that God was giving Moses, and Moses was giving it to the people of God because this is the kind of instruction that God desires for His children to have. Now, I want you to understand that we're talking about the children of God and what God wants the people instructed in. Look at verse 24 of Exodus 12. It said that you shall observe this thing for an ordinance to thee and to thy sons forever. So in other words, if you're going to train up a child in the way it should go, it's not just a one-time deal. You don't drop them off at children's church and you go back and you watch the saints. You got to TiVo for that. TiVo that. Okay? You don't just every now and then say just a prayer at the dinner table. I mean, it's better than nothing. But you learn the word of God and you instruct your children in the word of God. What God told Moses was you're going to observe this thing for an ordinance to you and for your sons forever. You know, just by many people that come to church here, you know this. But Jesus died on Passover night. This is about 1400 BC. So for 1400 years, every year, the children of Israel kept this Passover feast. And on the night that Jesus was crucified, he was the Passover lamb. That's some good stuff right there. God's plan is real. He's written it beforehand in his word. Amen. All we got to do is get in there and dig it out and find it. And we will become convinced that God is real and that his word wants to speak to us. In verse 25, it says, "It shall come to pass when you become to the land, which the Lord will give you according as he has promised, that you shall keep this service. And it shall come to pass when your children shall say unto you, what mean you by this service?" In other words, Daddy, why do we do this every year? I don't understand it. Every time I get close to this lamb of mine, you go snatch it up and you cut its throat and you drain its blood. And we go through this whole process. We roast this lamb. We eat these bitter herbs. We eat this unleavened bread. Why are we doing this, Dad? He said, God said, you're going to do this every year and your kids are going to take notice of it. If you as a Christian father will instruct your children in the ways of God, they're going to understand it and they're going to realize, you know what, it's going to start getting on the inside of them. They're going to start asking some questions. It said right here, verse 27, that you shall say it is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, who passed over the house of the children of Israel in Egypt when he smote the Egyptians and he delivered our houses, and the people bowed the head in worship. When your children start to ask you, Daddy, why is it that we do this? You're going to have the opportunity to tell them, because the God that we serve delivered us out of slavery. Amen. The God we serve provided a sacrifice, and the shedding of that sacrifice's blood delivered us out of the bondage of slavery. You must be born again. The first time you were born like your father Adam. You must be born again in Christ. Amen. The blood of the eternal lamb was shed, and now when you put your faith in that, righteousness is given to you. Amen. Let's turn to Psalm 127. I'm getting close. Hang in there with me. Psalm 127, verse 3. Psalm 127, verse 3. Y'all ready? It says, "Lo, children are a heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward." You know, what I wanted to go there was this, is that the word heritage is also used in the Bible to describe the property that God gave Israel as a gift. You know, God gave a promise to a man named Abraham. We talk about Abraham a lot in this church because, see, that's how it all kind of really got started, that God gave a promise to Abraham. He said, "Come out from your father's house and I'm going to make you a nation." And through Abraham, God gave us Israel. And through Israel, he gave us Jesus. But he didn't only give promise to Abraham that through his seed, which ultimately Paul tells us was Jesus, but also he gave him a promise that there would be a land for him. Abraham never saw it. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11 that Abraham was on a journey and that he looked for a city whose builder and maker was God. In other words, he looked for that eternal home. And I pray, Lord, help me to be like Abraham, that I'd keep my eyes fixed, Lord, on what the prize is. Amen?
Amen.
But what I want you to know is that he never saw it. But as Israel came in, we've been studying this here recently. We studied about the feast. We studied about the Sabbaths. We studied this just actually Thursday night, about the fact that the land also had a Sabbath rest. Every seventh year, they weren't supposed to put the plow to the ground. They disobeyed God. They went after false gods. They went after the wrong kind of women that turned their hearts away from God and caused them to go after the false gods. And not only that, they said, you know what, while I'm doing all this, I don't have to not listen to God. I'll put the plow to the ground in the seventh year if I want to, because I don't have to worry about God's provision. Everything's working fine for me. And in a similar fashion, I wanted you to know that the property that God gave to Israel was his, and the children of Israel didn't take care of it. And this scripture is basically saying the same thing. The children that God has given to you are His. They don't really belong to you. They don't really belong to you. And listen, until you and I get that inside of our head and inside of our hearts, it's going to be difficult for us to try to handle and instruct our children in the way that God desires for us to. But you need to understand that God is the one. Listen, He's supposed to be in control of your finances. He's supposed to be in control of your life, your walk. He's supposed to be in control of how you handle your children. Now, I understand that we're not perfect in all those things. And that many times we desire to go our own way. I'm telling you what the Word of God says. Amen. That He desires, He's given us certain things and He's entrusting us with that. It has the idea of stewardship behind it. You don't have to turn there if you don't want, but Matthew chapter 25 is the parable of the talents. I'm not going to go through the whole thing, but I did want to point out to you a couple of things. Number one, you remember the story about the parable of the talents that God gave, that the Lord gave five, it's like talking about a type of money. He gave five to one man, He gave two to another, and He gave one to one. And He went on a journey. That's representative of the Lord. He's gone on a journey. He told Philip, I'm going, in my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. And He said, I'm coming back again. So one day God's coming back again. We taught this a little while back about the judgment seat of Christ. The judgment seat of Christ isn't the great white throne judgment. The great white throne judgment is wherever humanity that refused Jesus will be judged. The judgment seat of Christ is where Christians will be judged for their works. So in this parable, the good man has gone on a journey. He left talents. He's coming back to settle accounts one day. He's left you to navigate your Christian journey. He's coming back to settle accounts with you one day. The one that He gave five to doubled it and got five. The one He gave two to doubled it and got two. But then there was one who He called a wicked servant. He dug his in the ground. One of the things that He said right here was, in verse 25 of chapter 25, He said, I was afraid. It says right here, let me go back. It says, verse 24, then he which had received the one talent came and said, Lord, I knew you, that you are a hard man. Well, hold on a second, Hoss. You obviously didn't know him. Because the Lord wasn't a hard man to begin with. The Lord gave you the talent. And He only gave you one. He didn't put too much on your back that you couldn't handle. He only gave you one. You didn't know Him. That was the problem. Many times people think that they know God. They fear Him as though He's some mean father that wants to beat them down. When the reality of it is that He gave you Jesus. And in this case, He gave you your children to begin with. He said, I didn't know you. I know He said, I knew you, but in reality, He didn't know him. And it says right here, verse 25, I was afraid, and I went and I hid my talent in the earth, and there thou hast that is thine. Here you go. You can have it. I saved it for you. Well, this is what the Lord said. The Lord answered and said unto him, you wicked and slothful servant. You knew that I reap where I sowed and not, and gather where I have not strawed. He called him slothful. And the word slothful means that he delayed. He put it off. This is going to be all right tomorrow. As I'm talking, you can turn to Ephesians chapter 6. I'm going to put it off tomorrow. I mean, I know we got a problem. You hear what I'm saying? I know we got a problem. Because the little girl just backtalked me. But we're going to just put it off till tomorrow. It's going to be all right. She just rolled her eyes at me whenever I talked to her and tried to tell her something important. But it's going to be okay. We'll just delay it a little bit. We don't have to jump on it that quick. Chapter 6, verse 4. It says, and you fathers, provoke not your children to anger. In other words, you're not supposed to ride them so bad that you exasperate them and wear them out. That's not what I'm trying to communicate here. I'm talking about instruction edifies, which means to build up. It says, fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. The word nurture describes mostly discipline connected to it. And I'm going to focus on that word for a second. The word admonition has encouragement connected to it. You need both of them as you instruct children. Amen? You can't just sit there and tell them everything that they're doing wrong. A child needs to be able to hear whenever they do something right. Yeah, but I'm spending so much time telling that boy or that girl where he's going wrong that I'm just too tired to tell him whenever he's doing right. You need to pay attention. You need to pay attention to what your children are doing, and whenever you find that they've done something good, you need to break down, you need to take the time, and you need to encourage them in it. Amen? But what I want you to focus on, I want to focus on nurture. The word in the Greek is I like this word because it kind of reminds me of something that I do, but it's, if you were going to spell it in English, this is it. Padia, and it's where we get, not Medea, Padia, and it's where we get the word pediatrics. And it has to do with children. But the word originally was mostly all about instruction, but then with time it evolved and it took upon its context the word discipline. Because all true instruction requires discipline. Both of these words, this is what really got me, and I wanted to make sure I didn't forget to tell you this. Both of these words engage the conscience, engage the will, engage the mind of the young person. So what I'm trying to tell you is this. When you're instructing your children and you see that little 3-year-old, 5-year-old, 6-year-old doing to you what them people were doing to me when I was trying to tell them about Jesus, and they got their head turned like that and your face is over here and they're over there looking over there. See, I couldn't reach over there and grab that old boy's chin. Pull it back. I'm talking to you about Jesus, man. You need to respect this. I couldn't do that. But what I want you to understand is that you're wasting your breath. If your child's not looking you in the eyeballs, if you stop them because they were playing something or whatever and did something that you didn't want them to do, and you said, hey, I want to talk to you, and they're still over there looking at that thing that they were just doing, they're not even listening to you. You understand what I'm getting at? You got to engage the conscience mind. You got to get into their will. You got to make a connection with them. And they need to take the time to listen to you. Listen to me, parent, child, father, mother, whoever you are. Don't pretend that it's okay when it's not. I can't tell you how many times I see people in the clinic and their kids are just doing it. These people are oblivious to everything that's going on. Have you ever noticed that? You probably haven't. I notice every little detail. Sometimes I think it's a curse. I would see everything that everybody's kid's doing, and the parent can't see nothing that's going on. I'm like, what's going on here? Have you just blinded yourself to this? If you don't do it, who's going to do it? Because then you're going to get mad whenever the preacher starts correcting your kids. Right? You don't want me doing it, do you? No, you don't. You go, oh, I ain't going back to that church. Preacher told my kids what to do. Somebody's got to tell them.
Amen.
Back in the day, bro, they would just tell you kids, they'd whoop them. Come on. By the time your kid got home, he done caught 3 whippings. The principal did it, the neighbor heard about it, he put it on them. And then when you got home, your mama, if she had any sense, she'd whip you and then wait till daddy gets home. They weren't scared to whip a kid back in the day. You got to get somebody's attention, man. Listen to me. Let's go ahead and turn to Proverbs 29. We're about to close this up. Psychology would tell you don't whip your children. I'm not telling you to beat your children. It's on film and we're not going to take it off. I believe in spanking. I called OCS up one time. I said, hey man, while I've got you on the phone about this, let me ask you something. Is it illegal in Louisiana to whip a kid? He said, look, I whip mine. I sure hope not. I'm like, that's what I'm talking about. How do you do it? Well, you know what? Sometimes people need a little bit of help. I know one thing. You don't have to do it my way. I don't really believe in hitting a kid with your hand, but you know, whenever they're little, it's kind of hard whenever they're in a diaper. You mean to tell me you struck your kid when they were in diapers? I sure did. 15 months old, you think a kid doesn't already know what they're doing? You've lost your mind. They're already working their manipulation on you at 15 months old. Whenever Sierra was 15 months old and she tried to backtalk me, I put her hand in my hand, slapped it real good. Oh, she felt it. I got her attention. How about I sit here playing games with you? I want to make that clear. I'm not playing games with you. I'm not just going to like, no, you're going to feel it. I got to get your attention. I got to get through to your will. I got to get past your distractions. I need you to quit looking over here to the east or the west. I need you to look me in the eyeballs. I got important words to instruct you with. This is the word of God. Your life hangs in the balance. If you want God to build a hedge of protection around you, if you want his word to be a lamp to your feet, a light to your path, and one day you walk out of my house and he's going to hold me accountable, turn your head, look at me, and if you rebel, you're going to get your hand smacked. Amen. And then when you get older, I'm going to put the belt on your butt and you're going to feel it. I never did it more than 3 times, but it didn't need to be done more than 3 times. Because it was hard enough the first 2 that I felt like if I did it the 3rd time, it was probably crossing the line, if you understand what I'm saying. You got to be careful you don't cross the line. You don't want to do it in anger. You're doing it out of love. Amen? You love your children. God loves you. He chastens those whom he loves. Amen? All right. Verse 29, chapter 29, verse 15. It says, the rod and reproof give wisdom, but a child left to himself brings his mother shame. I wanted to say that because I know it's a little bit different. Like, in other words, the way I was thinking of it, you know, the way the scripture's probably talking about it is that the parents just let the kid go his own way and they're not really involving themselves at all. I can't help getting the thought out of my mind whenever I'm at the clinic and these parents just can't see anything. And they're just basically leaving these kids to themselves. You know, and the same thing can happen in the church. We just ignore it. And it's like we don't see it. I'm just trying to encourage you, don't do that. Pay attention. If you don't instruct them and tell them, who will? Amen? I used to have a real bad attitude, and I used to tell people, I used to say, I know, somebody told me the other day that I was obnoxious and rude because I'm introducing myself into people's lives, but I used to tell people in the clinic when their kid acted up, I'd say, I really would appreciate it if you'd do a little bit better job. Because I'm spending a lot of time on my kids. I'm spending a lot of time on my kids, and you know what? One day your kid might go to school with my kid. Please help society out a little bit. I know, that's just straight up rude. But it's the truth. If I don't tell them, will they ever know? They don't go to church. I don't know, they probably didn't listen. But anyway, you get the point. Don't leave a kid to themselves. Don't ignore it. Amen? All right, I'm closing with this scripture right here. Proverbs 13, verse 24. It says in Proverbs 13, verse 24, he that spares his rod hates his son. Now, the rod is a form of judgment. The rod is a form of correction. It's once again to get somebody's attention. It's once again to interject that we got an issue here. I'm just telling you what the scripture says. He that spares his rod hates his son. But he that loves him chastens him betimes. I was like, what betimes? I've never even noticed that word before. As many times as I read that, I just would quote the first part of it, not even pay attention to it. And I was like, man, that's got to be an old King James word because we don't even use that word anymore. What in the world does that word mean? I loved it. I'm so glad I looked it up. The word betimes is also a word that would be used to describe the dawn or the early morning. In other words, he that loves chastens him early. It's not that he goes and snatches him out of the bed before the sun's up and says, let me put a whooping on you before the day gets started. That's what my principal told me one year when I walked up in the 8th grade. He said, Matt, you want to go ahead and come to the office and let's get some of this paddling out the way right now. That's not what the Word of God is talking about. It's talking about, once again, that you're in the midst of a circumstance. The child is acting up, not doing what it is that you asked them to do. You already instructed them, and now they're not listening. And so what you do is you're chasing them betimes. You're chasing them early. You get involved in the situation quick. You don't delay. You don't become slothful in it. I know you're tired. I'm tired too. We're all tired. We all work. Guess what? We got to do what's the most important. Amen? Listen, Lord, help us to stay out of our phone. Lord, help us to stay off Facebook long enough to pay attention. attention to what's going on with our children's lives so that we might be able to instruct them, amen, and to correct them. Praise God.
Thank you, Lord.